following is a local resident producers program. The program content is the sole responsibility of the producer and does not necessarily reflect the views or policies of CATV2, Oshkosh Community Media Services, the City of Oshkosh, or Time Warner Cable.
Hi everybody, welcome to Eye on Oshkosh. Cheryl Hentz here along with Dan Rylance, and we're here to discuss Act 10. That of course is the law that was put through last, I think, January or February, concerning state workers, county workers, city workers, basically any public sector worker, and it caused a lot of uproar in the state and has continued to cause uproar. We're taping this on Thursday, October 20th, and
September.
September. One week prior to this, on last Friday, a Dane County judge basically ruled that Act 10 is essentially unconstitutional in violation of both state and federal constitutions, according to the judge's ruling. He declared it null and void. And there's going to be appeal after appeal after appeal. But here to kind of sort through the most recent ruling, what it means, where we go from here, and just how long it's going to take us to get to the end of this saga, to help us iron all that out and see hopefully some light at the end of the tunnel, is local attorney, a longtime very prominent attorney in Oshkosh, George Curtis. Thank you for being here. Yes.
Thanks for inviting me.
Welcome, Diane.
I appreciate it very, very much. You're in a whole different setting than your own. You've got two shows here on Channel 2, and you tape them in your office. And so this is a brand new set
I do.
For you. So, anyway, welcome. Thanks again for being here. Let's just jump right into this. The judge said it violates both constitutions. What exactly does that mean?
Well, it means it's null and void if it violates the Constitution. And this isn't the first judge who said so. We had a federal judge back on the end of March who also decided on similar but not identical grounds that it violated the Constitution. The state Constitution and the federal Constitution are very, very similar when it comes to matters of equal treatment, free speech, the power of association, and that sort of thing. The state judge, in the decision that was just a week or so ago, probably went a little bit further than the federal judge, but they agreed on quite a number of things. They agreed that, first of all, that there was disparate treatment, or equal protection, with respect to some classifications that had no basis in fact. The act distinguished between general employees and public safety employees, and people who were not union members at all, and treated them very, very differently. And both judges seemed to think that the reasons for treating them differently were political and not based in reality. Okay. How differently were they treated? Greatly differently. The so-called safety employees were a special category.
We're talking fire and police?
That's right.
Okay.
And not just fire and police, but primarily fire and police. Okay. Actually, there were a lot of fire and police people left out of it. And both judges observed those that were left out just happened to be unions that had backed Governor Walker's opponent by endorsing him in the last election. And those that were included happened to be unions that endorsed Governor Walker. I mean, for example, the Capitol Police not included in this protective category. The Capitol Fire people, not included. The university police and fire, not included. The DNR employees, the prison employees, a lot of groups that would normally be in the safety group were not included. And both judges noted that it was interesting that all of the unions that had endorsed Governor Walker were included in this special category, and all those that had endorsed his opponent were not included. What difference did it make? Oh, a big difference. The public safety employees didn't give up their rights to negotiate. They didn't give up their rights to collective bargaining. They didn't give up their rights to have the dues taken right out of their paycheck by their employer. They didn't give up their right to obtain some benefit from the non-members in their bargaining unit who got the benefit from their negotiating. They really didn't give up any rights. At the other extreme, there was a classification of people who were not union members. Those people, incidentally, were not limited in terms of wage increases. They couldn't be compelled to contribute anything. There was no limit on the subjects that they could negotiate about. They really got a free ride. In fact, they got some very clear encouragement to not join a union. Now, how about the people in between, the general employees? They're the people who didn't benefit from being public safety employees, didn't back Walker. What did they get? Well, they got a stone under their Christmas tree. First of all, they lost their rights to negotiate. Secondly, they could not have their union dues taken out of their paycheck. They really had to be recertified every year, and there's not another law in the United States that requires a union to be recertified every year. The protected group, the public safety group, never have to be recertified unless 30% of the members insist on it. Here they have to do it every year, and if they don't do it on time and they've lost it entirely, it's an expense to be recertified. Yep. And then it goes to the extreme where they have to have a majority of all of their members vote for the recertification, not just the members that are voting. In other words, it's been made almost impossible to be recertified.
It's to destroy the union.
Well, clearly this is union destruction. Right. That's all it is. Now, that's just some of the discussion on the disparate treatment of these different classifications, which are new classifications. They were invented to accomplish the union destruction in this particular case. The decisions also deal with the freedom to associate, the freedom of speech, and the problem with the constitutional protection of the Milwaukee Home Rule. Those are some of the things that were held to be unconstitutional. There are some other subjects that were not held to be unconstitutional that really, when this goes up on appeal, will be discussed. There may be more and different bases that an appellate court decides make it unconstitutional, but I've given a speech and I should have been answering a question.
No, that's good.
Because you broke it down very clearly and very succinctly. So this judge, George, has said, okay, it's unconstitutional, I'm declaring it null and void. Well, we know that it's going to be appealed, and then it will be appealed again. This thing will be appealed to death. But as it goes through the appeal process, where are we at right now? What do these workers have as rights currently with this being declared null and void? Do things automatically go back to the way they were before Act 10 went into effect as a law?
If there is no stay on this decision, yes.
Which the Attorney General has asked for, right?
That's right.
Yeah.
And you have a similar question with respect to the federal case, which is on appeal before the district court right now. And I think the 24th of September, which is this month, that's going to be argued there. And similar but not identical issues, and the issue there will be a stay as well. And we're just assuming, and we should not assume, that these are the only two lawsuits, because there are many other potential groups that may well bring a lawsuit.
Maybe we could stop for a minute. Some of the groups aren't in this lawsuit. So who is in this lawsuit and who is not? Like, I don't think UW, University of Wisconsin, people are in it at all. No. We're talking about school districts?
Well, the federal lawsuit had, I think, seven of your biggest public employee labor unions.
Okay.
Interestingly, they filed that in the federal court system.
Okay. Okay.
And I haven't had a chance to talk to those lawyers to find out why they picked the federal court system.
Okay.
But of course, there are some federal issues that are different than state issues. And we're all litigators are out judge shopping to a certain degree.
Sure.
And there are some people who may see the federal district court and court of appeals as a little more liberal than the Wisconsin Supreme Court, which right now can't seem to agree on what is a chokehold, where we've got the people fighting between themselves. So who knows how that will come down.
For city Oshkosh people, who is in it and who's not in this suit? City employees have lost their collective, are they connected to this suit?
I don't know that they're in either of these lawsuits or that they aren't.
Okay.
I can't answer that question, but under the two laws that we're talking about, Act 10 and Act 32, the city of Oshkosh employees that don't qualify as public safety employees really lost all of their rights in the legislation.
Mm-hmm. Right. How about school teachers?
Oh, that was the target.
Okay.
The school teachers have supported Democratic candidates so long they were the target.
Okay.
And of course, the follow-up after taking away their rights was to make sure they started contributing heavily to their health plans and things like that. This was seen by politicians as an anti-school teacher bill. Even when the governor was interviewed by the fake cook, the guy, he admitted the whole plan was to divide and conquer and set these people against each other and set the public employees, the middle class public employees who are really carrying a big load in terms of taxes and their sacrifice for the community, against the middle class private employees who are also carrying the big load. The man is not unintelligent.
Yeah.
This divide and conquer has really worked. And then he set the public employees in the public safety group against those that aren't in the safety group. And he has encouraged the people to not join unions at all by really putting no limitations at all on them. It's really worked.
Yes.
George, how much do you think that little soundbite of his from the Koch brothers, the fake Koch brother phone conversation, will come back to bite him in the rear end, if at all, throughout this litigation?
Well, I frankly think that people have short memories, and it'll be brought up in the litigation. Mm-hmm. I think it reveals what his strategy was, I really have to admit that it was deception on the part of the fake cook, and I'm not for that either. I'm not against somebody just because of what political party they happen to belong to, but clearly, this was a well-planned coup, and clearly, he knew that right after the election, he had the votes to do it, and he didn't even tip his hand in describing the special session. The Constitution says you have to carefully describe it, and that's all you can do. Well, he disguised it. He didn't describe it accurately. And then when the legislation came through, it really wasn't to fix a budget at all.
No.
And the Democrats realized they'd been had. They claim they tried to negotiate. The Republicans claim they tried to negotiate. I'm not sure either one did. Yeah. And when the Democrats realized he had the votes to ram it through, that's when they ran off to Illinois.
Right.
And that caper is going to come back to bite the Democrats, too. A lot of people were offended by that, and I didn't much like it. But they can count votes, just like the Republicans. And they found out they couldn't pass the legislation without one more body.
Right.
And
right.
So the Democrats went in hiding in a hotel someplace in Illinois. Well, the Republicans have lawyers too, and they figured out if they took the finance issues out of the legislation, they didn't need as high a majority.
Sure.
And so they took the finance issues out of the budget repair bill. Now, how do you do that?
Yeah.
And still have a budget repair bill.
Right.
But that's what they did, and that's how they passed it. And it became the law. Now it's being challenged constitutionally. The challenges are legitimate. I've read the briefs on both sides. Mm-hmm. They're excellent. Uh-huh. Got good lawyers uh-huh. on both sides. That whole chapter of Wisconsin history is going to end up in a good book, as I mentioned in our discussion before the program.
2012, for many reasons, is going to be a good book.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Now, obviously, because you know the state employees were not part of these lawsuits, but what kind of repercussions, if any, might any of these decisions along the way, or maybe the very final decision, once this all is done being litigated, what kind of repercussions might that have for state employees, even though they weren't part of the lawsuit?
Well, they don't have to be part of the lawsuit to get the harm or the benefit mm-hmm. in many cases, but they may have to be a part of a lawsuit mm-hmm. to turn backward or reverse a contract. Mm-hmm. They authorize somebody to represent them in a contract that resulted from a belief that this was a valid law, no matter how distasteful. This is probably going to affect unions and members. Many people quit unions because why should we pay for a union where if we pay, everybody else gets a free ride for not paying? You think we're stupid? So there are going to be some litigation involving unions and maybe unions and their members. Then the question is, what about contracts that were executed believing this law was enforceable? Can they get out of them? This is going to be good for lawyers.
And it's going to go on for a long time.
Oh, yes.
So, all right, Attorney General Van Hollen is appealing this. Give us sort of an itinerary here, if you will, a roadmap of where this is going to go and in what sort of steps. He'll appeal to whom?
All right. Well, that's a good one because there are a couple of options. First of all, he's asking for a stay, mm-hmm. saying that this would do a lot of damage, and in case this doesn't turn out to be the right decision, why should you upset contracts all over the state? We should have a stay. That's a good argument, mm-hmm. frankly.
And it would prevent these people from doing something, right? Oh,
they're already starting to try to negotiate.
Of course they are. Of course they are. Then he has to take the next step, which I think is the 4th District Court of Appeals, a three-lawyer appeal mm-hmm. group based down there in Madison. That's the normal process. Every case, you have a right of appeal from a final order. That's important because very often they're kicked back saying, we don't have a final order. Your appeal is really premature, and so we're not going to take your case yet. You have to go through a trial or you have to go through a certain process. But the normal appeal is from the trial court, which you have as a matter of right to the appellate court. And any case can be appealed to the appellate court. Now, the appellate court can take the appeal or can pass the buck. And it often passes the buck, saying this is something that eventually is going to go to the Wisconsin Supreme Court. We want to duck it, and we ask the court to take jurisdiction of it right now. Now, the appeal to the Wisconsin Supreme Court is not a matter of right. The Wisconsin Supreme Court can decide not to take it, and they often do. Or they send it back and say, we want a fact-finding hearing on this, this, and this, and this. We need something to work with. We need some evidence of the impact on the parties or whatever. So the Wisconsin Supreme Court can pass the buck or delay it or say, no, you go all the way back to the trial court. Not all of the issues were fully litigated. And then you go through the next step, the intermediate appellate court, and then you come to see us, and we're talking about a year and a half, 2 years down the pike, if that happens. Now, there's a different track going with the federal case. The federal case was decided at the trial court level. On the 24th, they're going to argue to the appellate court, and that court may do one of several things, too. It may also choose to bypass and try to get the United States Supreme Court to take it over. But I think the percentage of cases that the United States Supreme Court accepts are just
very small.
Absolutely. Successful med mal cases in Wisconsin or moose sightings. Little dig in there.
But whatever happens, your time period is not short. We're looking at a year, year and a half.
I would think that would be fortunate, because just because some of the unions decided to fight,
right,
many of them were timid, and they're encouraged by these two decisions, and say their members are going to be bugging them. Why are we sitting around here oiling our revolvers? We ought to get in the fight. Mm-hmm. And so I'm of the opinion that unless something real decisive happens, there's going to be more litigation and more litigation about these issues.
George, let me get some clarification here, because one of the TV stations said that even though they weren't named plaintiffs in this particular suit that was ruled on last week, that if you were a city employee or a county employee or a teacher, you were basically part of this lawsuit. Now, I don't know if they filed it as kind of like a class action suit, or exactly, you know, if these unions that did filed it as part of a class action suit that sort of covered everybody, or what exactly. But who exactly, I mean, is that factual, that, say, Winnebago County employees,
well,
do they have
they would benefit if the law that put them in prison is declared unconstitutional, but if they aren't parties, they aren't going to have a judgment to collect costs on or execute on.
Okay.
So that, yes, declaring the death penalty unconstitutional helps everybody on death row.
Okay.
But that's a secondary aid. Mm-hmm. If you're not a party, you're not going to get a judgment.
Okay. All right.
I think if someone unclear specifically who is in this and who isn't. We haven't had a good, you know, thorough discussion in the media or in the press that really says, you know, exactly who is in this. And then George brings up this federal thing, which I think some people have forgotten. There's really two things going on, one at the state level and one at the federal level. It's very confusing.
Yeah. So, can we eventually see an end to this?
Well,
or is this just going to keep going back and forth, and until we're all ready to collapse?
First of all, I think the answer to your question came from the AG's briefing people. They said to the court, "Mind your own business. The judicial branch has nothing to do with this. This is politics." And of course, quite a confession.
Yeah.
That's exactly what
it was.
And God bless, we have courts, right? We can do this.
That's right. I don't know that there will be an end to it. Please understand that Wisconsin isn't the only place that this is going on. There are some cases in Michigan that have been decided pretty much the way these cases have been decided. The politicians in Michigan decided to fix the teachers. Mm-hmm. And among all of the public employees, they said it was okay to take the dues out of the checks for all public employees except teachers. Of course, that was held to be unconstitutional.
I hope so.
They had an analogous case in Arizona where some people were more equal than others. Mm-hmm. And this is something politicians use to damage the support base of the other side, mm-hmm, and to enhance their support base. That's politics. I think Van Hollen's brief didn't mean to be quite that honest. This was all politics. It's all union busting,
yeah,
and it's all about damaging the the public employees who traditionally have supported the Democrats, and the Democrats, I'm sure, in exchange have been kind to them, and now the Republicans had the power and they used it. Mm-hmm. Question is, did they abuse it?
Mm-hmm. Well, that is the question, and that's the multi-million dollar question, and I just don't know when we're going to see the end of it. Do you have anything else real
just
quick?
One. Because we're running if out you of time. Were representing the Madison School District, who's in this suit, would you advise them to do something right away?
Well, if they could get somebody on the other side to do something mm-hmm. right away, yes, mm-hmm. I think you take advantage of your mm-hmm. victory. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. The law that made you enter into a bad marriage mm-hmm. is now void, and you can go out looking for a better bride.
And without a stay, that's go for it.
Absolutely.
All right. Well, let's say that something like that can happen, and someone does. As we said, people are starting to renegotiate or try to renegotiate some of their contracts already. Let's say someone is successful in doing that before a stay is granted. Then let's say the stay gets granted, then what? Does that undo the new contract, the new deal that they just cut?
It depends on what the decision mm-hmm. says. Mm-hmm. And, of course, you're leading up to the chaos that we're going to be facing. Mm-hmm. We are facing potential chaos, mm-hmm. there's no question about it. This Walker Law, as I refer to it, Acts 10 and Act 32, it just about devastated many segments of public employees. We have never had so many judges, policemen, district attorneys retire instantly, because as one of the judges of very close to here told me, if he didn't retire in June, he was going to lose over $200,000 in his pension. Mm-hmm. This was an open, clear attack on public employees. It was a very, very well done choreographed way of pitting the public employees against private employees, where they thought each other was the enemy, and instead of the corporations that may well be the enemy or should have been the enemy. And I think that education has really taken a body blow. It's a great job if that's what they wanted to accomplish, to convince so many people that their teachers are not good public servants, not there for the kids, and they're overpaid. My mother was a teacher, my wife's a teacher, my aunt's a teacher.
They're overpaid.
I'd make more money standing on the corner telling people which way the post office is when you figure out the hours they put in.
Well, that's exactly
and enrollment
right.
of schools of education in Wisconsin are way down because kids are looking at this and are saying, do I want to be a teacher?
Not in this climate. Nobody would want to be a teacher. It really was a body blow to education. There's no question about that. And, of course, I talked to one of the young judges here about the impact on him. Now, he's a young judge. He doesn't have all this money invested over the years. And he just said, well, it just delayed my retirement by 6 years. So it hits public employees everywhere. The DAs, the DA's assistants, and the public defenders haven't been getting raises, and they're looking for work. We want good people in public service, and they shouldn't be paid necessarily more than people with comparable education in private service. But your average school teacher, I think, has a master's degree and is required to go back to college about every third summer on her own nickel. Now you compare that with people with a comparable education in the private sector, and they're underpaid.
Yep. All right. On that note, we have to end. But thank you very much for trying to help us sort through this, and it's going to be interesting to see how it all unfolds. Just sit tight, George. We're going to take a short break. When we come back, we'll be chatting with Jessica King's opponent in the upcoming senatorial race, Rick Gudex. We'll be right back.
Every year, the U.S. Department of the Treasury receives about 1.4 million reports of problems with paper checks. Checks can be lost, stolen, or delayed. If you still receive Social Security payments by paper check, Treasury wants you to know about a safer, more convenient way to get your money. The Direct Express Prepaid Debit MasterCard. The Direct Express card is new and is available to anyone receiving Social Security benefits, even if you don't have a bank account. Your monthly benefits will be automatically placed onto your card account each month on the day your money is due. While other debit cards cost money, it is possible to use the Direct Express card for free to make purchases, pay bills, and get cash at thousands of locations nationwide. There are no sign-up or monthly account fees, no more waiting for the mail, or worrying about lost or stolen checks. Call 1-877-212-9991 or visit www.usdirectexpress.com.
Rick joins us now. He is the Republican candidate seeking the senatorial seat, the state senatorial seat in the 18th Senate District against Jessica King. Welcome. We appreciate you very much for being here.
Thank you for coming.
Tell us a little bit about yourself. We always start out with candidates, you know, especially ones who haven't been here before, by finding out a little about you and why you're running.
I'm a resident from Fond du Lac, and I work at Brenner Tank in Fond du Lac. I'm a production manager. I've been in production management for 24 years. I'm also the city council president of the city of Fond du Lac. I've been president now. This is my third year. Okay. Been on council for four. Prior to that, I was also at the city of Mayville. I was on the city council there, and I was also the mayor of the city of Mayville at one time. So I'm married. I have a wife, Kim, 18 years. I've got a son who's a junior in high school, and I've got a daughter in fifth grade. So we've got a good family thing going, and they're fully supportive of my campaign as well. As far as for why I'm running for Senate, I just want to be able to go into this Senate race helping business, growing jobs, moving the economy forward, and using all the experience I've had from both local government and business to accomplish that goal.
Okay. You've been on the city council now for how long in Fond du Lac?
I'm in my fourth year.
In your fourth year.
Third year as president.
Okay. What kinds of legislation have you brought forward there that have helped to grow jobs in Fond du Lac?
Well, some of the things we've done a lot of work with area businesses as far as helping them with grant assistance and things of that nature. As a matter of fact, right now we've got three expansion projects going on in Fond du Lac. One of those businesses is actually putting in a rail spur, which is kind of unheard of nowadays, but their business, McNeil Steel, has done very well in the short 2-3 years that it's been in Fond du Lac, and are looking to expand. We've also got another expansion at Wells Manufacturing. We've got a groundbreaking coming up soon, and we've got all kinds of little projects going on as well. So, we've kind of prided ourselves over the years of creating an atmosphere where business grows and prospers, and we've always had a good working relationship with business.
Okay.
We live in a world of polls. Every day there's a poll this way.
Sure.
This week's been a big week for Democrats and not such a good week for Republicans. Your president candidate, Romney, has slipped badly in these polls. And for the first time, we see maybe a shirt tail effect in that Tammy Baldwin has gained somewhat on Tommy Thompson for the Senate race.
Sure.
So my question is for you, if this continues, are you worried about shirt tail effects going down to the 18th Senate?
I'm not worried. I think that my message is a very good message. You know, I'll be honest, I've been out since January doing doors and talking to people, and the message I have, which revolves basically around business, jobs, and economy, is resounding very well, not only in the Fond du Lac area, but also in the Oshkosh area. Mm-hmm. People are worried about pocketbook issues. They're worried about taxes. They're worried about jobs. Their kids are graduating from college. They're graduating from high school. What future do they have? And that's where I feel, with my experience, I can bring forward a positive outlook for those family members and say that, look, we're going to be creating jobs, we're going to be working with business, we're going to keep things moving forward here in Wisconsin.
Isn't every candidate running on that?
I don't know. I don't know what other candidates are running.
Yeah, I mean,
I know that
it's
that's
jobs,
what I'm running
jobs,
on.
Everyone, but the question you is, know, how are you going to create the jobs?
Well, you know, we're gonna work with business. I mean, that's what you have to do. You okay. can't. I mean, we're gonna support things like mining legislation. I mean, okay. those are the kinds of things that I'm going to do.
So, mining legislation, I will be the first one to admit I don't know that much about the particular issue.
I agree. I'm with you. I don't know all the particulars.
I'll make it not so tough of a question then.
All right.
But, I mean, I do know that it's an issue of jobs versus basically environment. Are you just taking a very hardline approach that, hey, it's good for jobs, therefore it's good for the economy, so the heck with the environmentalists?
You know what, I'll take a hardline approach saying that it's good for jobs, but I'll also take a hardline approach that it's not bad for the economy. The type of mining that's being proposed up in that area is magnetic mining. It's not using chemicals and acids like you would have in other types of mining. So there really isn't any damage to any environmental things going on. Also, the DNR has said that this is okay. They permitted this to happen. We're doing it in neighboring states. Why can't we do it in Wisconsin? It comes down to, you know, at what point do you want to actually say that Wisconsin's open for business and truly mean what you say? And at what point do you want to, you know, lean towards the other side and say, look, you know, we have to do all this? Look, there were almost 20 amendments, or there were over 20 amendments that were put forth by the Democrats to put into this mining legislation. All 20 of those things were passed by the Republicans. I believe that if there were another 20 amendments, it still wouldn't have passed. So, you know, and I think that we were just at a time where, you know, Governor Walker was up for a recall and he wasn't going to get a win. And that's, you know, just how I feel about it.
As someone who's worked locally, mm-hmm. how good is the mining bill for local impact on roads and school aid and stuff, where the impact, you know, it's good for jobs, but there's sure. a large economic impact negatively that comes to that area.
I think there's more positive. I think if you look at the area that is being slated for the mining, their median income up there for a family is $35,000.
Okay.
I don't know how many people around this area could survive on $35,000, but they do it every day up there. You know, they're talking about creating jobs up there that would be in the $80,000 range. I think that's huge, and I think that's something that can't be ignored. You know, yeah, there's all kinds of things that need to go along with the mining. Mm-hmm. You know, we need to be responsible in how we do things. Obviously, there's enough things in the bill that cover those issues. And I think that, you know, it would have just been a good win for Wisconsin overall. I wish it wouldn't have came down to party politics.
That's true.
I mean,
really, everything
really,
does.
Yeah. Really. I mean,
yeah.
You know, you got to be able to look across the aisle, shake hands, and let's move forward with good legislation.
Would you agree that this is really an important Senate race, because maybe the control of the Senate hinges on this seat and maybe two or three others?
Well, I think that it does. I think it's important for the Democrats to be able to hold on to the mm-hmm. Senate, and I think it's important for the Republicans to get the shift the other way. So you're absolutely right. I think that, you know, the Senate races will be contested pretty heavily. I would say that this is going to be one of those races. Mm-hmm. I probably a couple others here in the state that will be contested. So yeah, it's important. I mean, philosophically and ideology, you know, ideological, I mean, it is going to be important in the direction of the state.
I want to talk about money for a second.
Okay.
Because this is a pivotal race.
Sure.
Where are you getting your money?
Well, we're getting money from private supporters right now. I mean, we've gotten a lot of support from just the grassroots effort. I mean, it's not uncommon to get in, you know, money from people that, you know, typically don't deal with politics. I mean, there's people that send letters saying, you know, I've never really given a political party before, but, you know, I like what you have to say, so we're giving you money. I'm getting support from other areas, you know, businesses and the like. So,
state, out of state money?
There might have been a few checks out of state. Yeah, you know, I would probably think so. I'm sure you know, Ms. King's getting her money out of state as well. So
you're running some TV and radio ads, and I can't get all of the disclaimer on there, but we talked about that before. What's the name of the group that's running?
Well, yeah, let's be clear. I'm not running any TV ads. It's a third party ad.
Right.
I didn't have anything to do
with
it.
Nothing to do with that.
No, absolutely not. I believe it was the American Federation for Children.
Yeah. So, what is that?
Yeah, what is that? Do you know?
I think they're a group that supports school choice.
So based in where?
I don't know where they're based out of. It's okay. All the information I have on it.
Okay. But they're running regularly, right?
They're running regularly. I grant you that.
You probably don't even have to run any, because they're running for you.
No, I'm sure we'll have our commercials as well. But
you know, we always talk about with politicians, campaign finance reform. Everybody seems to be for it, whether they're an elected official already or they're running for office. You know, I'm sure you're probably for campaign finance reform,
yeah,
too.
I think it's definitely something that needs to be looked at. I mean, to be able to run for a Senate seat, I mean, to be in the six figures for something like this,
yeah,
I mean,
crazy.
It doesn't make sense. I mean, it just literally doesn't. But if you don't, you're the odd person out. So, you know, it's bad that it's gotten to that point, but you know what? Mm-hmm. You have to do what you have to do. And, you know, until something changes, you just need to keep moving forward.
Sure. Would you be in favor of or vote for legislation that would basically prohibit these third-party ads?
I'm in favor of looking at any piece of legislation that comes across. You know, I'm kind of one of these people, and if you follow me at all, you know, I'm willing to listen to anybody and take their ideas and try and make the best out of both situations. It's just the type of person I am. So to answer your question, I'd be willing to listen to it.
Okay.
Sure.
All right.
Sure.
We have a lightning round. I did the same questions with your opponent.
All right.
And so the rules are, and mainly because we want to get, you either got to answer yes, no, or pass.
Okay.
We want to do it quick.
All
okay.
Right.
Should the recall provision remain in the state constitution?
The recall provision remain?
Yeah, in the state constitution. We have that in there. We know we've had recalls.
No, we shouldn't.
Get it out of the constitution.
Get it out of the constitution.
Okay. If the voter ID bill comes back, and it may come back, would you vote for it again?
Absolutely.
Okay. Would you support increased funding for K-12 education in the UW system?
You know, I'm willing to look at that, yes.
Okay. How about state funding for Planned Parenthood?
No.
Okay. As a local person, should Act 10 be amended to include rather than exclude the security, police, and fire employees?
I believe so, yes.
Okay. Would you support a constitutional amendment, this is a Tea Party thing, to allow citizens of Wisconsin to amend the Constitution by petition?
I believe that's a fair, yes.
Okay.
All right.
Do you want to leapfrog or go back?
Well, sure. Yeah, the voter ID bill.
Yeah.
I mean, we can start there. When Senator Hopper was in this particular seat, he said that the voter ID bill was to, quote, protect the democratic process. You obviously are in favor of the voter ID bill. What evidence is there that you're aware of that the process, the democratic process as we know it, has to be protected?
Well, let's just be honest about this. This whole voter ID thing is blown up, and to me, it's kind of ridiculous. You can't buy alcohol without an ID. You can't get in the Democratic National Convention without an ID. You know, what's wrong with having an ID to vote? I mean, even people in other countries like Iraq have to dip their finger in ink to show that they voted. I don't understand why it's so controversial for someone to get an ID.
Perhaps
to
it's
go
the way
vote.
It's written, and that it does prohibit
Well,
let me finish my
question,
though, Rick.
Sure, go ahead.
You know, perhaps it's because it's written in such a way that it does make it exceedingly hard for a certain segment of our voting population.
In what way?
Well, in a way where you've got elderly people who maybe don't even have a birth certificate because they're that age. In a way where it makes it very confusing for students. Let's also be clear, we have a constitutional right to vote. We don't necessarily have a constitutional right to fly on a plane to go to a Republican or a Democratic National Convention or to buy alcohol or medicine that contains alcohol.
Well, I'm okay with people voting, you know, but I think that you know, there is evidence of voter fraud, and I think that was what the bill was trying to curtail, was actually to make sure that that process, that constitutional process you talk about, is kept intact and is actually actually working the way it was designed to work.
Where was the fraud? Because I'll tell you what, this law, even though it had been passed, it wasn't being enforced, and you know, your Governor Walker, was reelected. A lot of Republicans managed to hold on to their seats.
Sure.
Excuse me, I would think that if there was so much voter fraud going on that we needed something like this, that wouldn't have happened.
Well, I don't have specifics for you, and I'm not going to get into that, but I know mm-hmm. that's one of the issues why we have voter ID, and I guess I'd reverse the question and say, what's wrong with having the voter ID? Is there some underlying reason why we shouldn't?
Well, let's make it fair then for people and not put such god-awful restrictions on it that make it next to impossible
I think the example you cited where someone truly doesn't have a birth certificate, they may be in their 80s or 90s, I think that, yeah, you're right, we probably should be willing to work with a person like that to get them something, but I think that's the 1%. You know, I think the other 99% shouldn't have any issue with having an ID to vote.
Why can't we just have a straight picture ID and not have these silly requirements for students? Wherever you're living at the time, why can't you just vote there and get a picture ID from that particular area and vote there? I mean,
well, like I said, you know, there's residency requirements that are in play today.
Okay.
that prohibits stuff like that from happening. So as long as those guidelines follow along with it, I'm willing to open and willing to talk.
Have you talked to, like, your city clerk or the three county clerks for your three counties about what they think about this bill?
Well, you know, I don't think they have a problem with the bill per se. I know that they're tired of all the elections that have gone on, just like any clerk throughout the state, and the cost in doing it, you're right. But no, they haven't really expressed anything to me personally.
There is no case in Wisconsin where any voter has been another voter. There's none of that.
That we know of. Right?
Well, there's like 60-some cases that they've done. The problems in the voting are mechanical, clerical errors and things. But as far as someone coming in and impostering some other voter, that's never been done in Wisconsin, which is, I guess, the purpose of having the voting.
Well, I'll take your word for that, because I don't have the facts on that.
Yeah, so. It was a pretty reasonable thing.
You want to talk about the Affordable Care Act?
I do, yeah. Okay. We want to talk about it. They're all against it, so we want to know about it.
I know in the scene.
I'm not really that versed on this.
Right. But
we're
no, exactly, because it's a huge act.
It is. It's thick.
But you did say in the scene, and probably in other interviews as well, that you support Governor Walker's statement that he is not going to enforce the Affordable Care Act, otherwise known as Obamacare. Why?
Well, I think that it comes down to, you know, is it going to be in play at the time it's required to be in play? I think that after the elections, things would, you know, possibly move in that direction if it needs to be. And I think that, you know, if that happens, I think that we should take the approach that the state should set up the exchanges and go in that direction. So I think it's just a waiting game. I don't think it's such a reluctance that, you know, we just aren't going to do this. I think that it's just a time thing right now to see what's going to happen here in the future. So
the states do have the ability to set up the health care exchange,
right?
And in fact, Governor Walker sent the federal money back,
right?
So I guess I don't understand your answer.
Well, I guess what I'm saying is that if it needs to get put in place, you know, I think that there's a deadline. I don't know what the deadline is that it would have to be in place, but I think at that time, you know, we would probably have to comply. But you know, like I said, I'm not real versed on this, but you know, I think it, when it comes down to, is that we'll do it when we have to do it.
But the money's already been sent back.
What I'm saying.
So now, when we have to do it, because we either do it our way or we do it the federal government's way, he's already sent the money back. So now we'll have to pony up the money on our own to cover this.
Well, I guess you'll have to call Governor Walker and ask about that, because I wasn't there for that. So.
Oh, okay.
If that's fair, I mean, I don't know.
Well, yeah. I mean, it's fair. You support his position. So,
right.
And essentially, since he's not going to enforce it, then he's kind of breaking the law.
Okay.
All right. Well, let me find here what you said. Go ahead, Dan, ask a question.
Well, some of the provisions of the Affordable Care are already in place, and I'm just curious what you think of these. Prohibits denying coverage for a pre-existing condition.
That's probably one of the better things that came out of it.
Okay, now you've got kids that are getting, not quite, but what do you think of those 26 and under now can be in covered by their parents' insurance, whereas before it was lower?
You know, I don't know if that's necessary. I mean, at that age, shouldn't you be out working and having insurance on your own?
Statistics are that some of the highest percentage of people unemployed.
I guess I would rather work towards that goal rather than have them, you know, hang on. It's fine. Yeah. I mean, it's coverage one way or the other. But
okay, how about seniors, where they're reducing the donut hole in Part D or Part B of Medicare? Do you think that was a good idea?
Well, I think the Senior Care Act is where we're heading, right? We're under the Senior Care Act here in Wisconsin. We don't really have Part D, right?
Okay.
Right.
All right. How about expanding health care to more than 30 million people? Isn't that a good idea?
In some respects, I guess we got to figure out how we're going to pay for it.
Okay.
But,
all right.
Right.
Okay. I found what you said, and you said you agree with Governor Walker that voters should be heard in November if they want this new tax to be fully implemented regarding Obamacare. Is that just how you see it? You just see it as a new tax, and that's it?
Well, I think it's something that, you know, it's a monster in itself as far as how to implement it. I know that each day goes by, there's more things they're finding that could be erroneous with this bill, but you know, like I said in my statement there, and I'll stick to it, you know, wait and see what happens after the November elections. Like I said, I'm not extremely versed on this issue, and you know, I just don't care to get into it. I'd rather talk about, you know, positive things. That's kind of where I want to head with this.
Well, I think insurance for everybody is a positive thing. I think it's a needed thing. You apparently want people to be heard on it at the ballot box. Would you agree then that people should be heard on Act 10 and 32? Should we put those issues on a ballot then?
Well, so people can be heard on that? I didn't say it was on the ballot. I just said, well,
I'm saying.
Oh, should it be on the ballot?
You want people to be heard. That's what you said. You said you wanted people to be heard in November about whether they want this new tax regarding Obamacare implemented. So I'm saying, should we then have voters be heard on everything? Shouldn't they have had a chance then to be heard on Act 10?
I think that's what the process is all about, to get a hold of your state legislator and let them know how that works. I mean, isn't that what it's all about here? That you have the avenue to use through your legislator to hear your voice. I think that's the process that's in place right now. If you're talking about doing referendums for all of this stuff, I don't know if that's necessary or not. I mean, we have a, you know, you can change the way we do our government here if you want to, but, you know, we could referendum everything.
You know, though, Rick, if we would have had a constitutional amendment to allow people to refer an act passed by the legislature, Act 10 would have been referred. It would have gone to a vote of the people. There wouldn't have been a recall of the senators, and there wouldn't have been a recall of the governor. The people would have voted just like they did in Ohio, where they said, no, we don't want this bill. So that would have been one referendum that would have really, in this case, helped.
That's a viewpoint. Yeah. I grant you that.
Yeah. We've had recalls.
Right. I think everybody's recalled out.
I am.
Yeah. Absolutely.
If you win, do you keep your job?
No, I would not work on a full-time basis.
Okay.
I would definitely be a full-time senator.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sure.
What have you learned in the campaign that you didn't know before?
Well, I've campaigned before on the local level, which is much smaller scale.
All right. Well, what did you learn for the three counties? So,
well, I think what I'm learning is that you know, there's a difference in views from one area to another, and I think that, you know, just learning about the issues and what relates to the certain areas is really kind of intriguing to me. Mm-hmm. You know, I obviously have been doing doors. I've done thousands of doors since we've been in this process. And, you know, like I said, you know, people have been pretty receptive to what I have to say. You know, and I'll go back to saying that they're worried about pocketbook issues. And that's primarily what they're worried about. They're worried about tax increases. They're worried about jobs. Or
one out of eight employees in Winnebago County are public employees.
Okay.
Act 10 took $27 million a year out of take-home pay for those people. Are they asking you about that at all, or are they?
I've had some people that have talked to me about Act 10 and about their position.
Yeah.
You know, and I can relate to what they're saying. I mean, as far as, you know, listening to what they have to say.
You've got a lot of public employees in Dodge County too.
Yeah, we've only got a small portion of Dodge County.
Okay. It's
the bottom side of Winnebago.
You don't have all of Dodge County?
No, it's just a sliver of Waupun.
I didn't know that. So yes. Waupun is not in there?
Yeah. Well, the city of Waupun is in a total, but part of that is in Dodge County.
Okay. It's been gerrymandered, obviously.
Yeah. Probably with the last census thing, perhaps. One thing I do like about your website and the ads that someone is putting out for you is that one thing that drives me crazy is politicians who say, I'm going to do this, I'm going to change this, I'm going to roll back this. I haven't seen that with your material. It's not on your website, it's not on these third-party ads. It simply says, I will work toward such and such. And I think that's a much more genuine approach, because all of us know we're not fools. Nobody operates in a vacuum.
Right.
You know, and I get so tired of these politicians who say, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. You're not going to do anything by yourself.
Right.
You know, so thank you for that sincerity, at least.
Well, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Because
it is the type of person I am. I mean, I wasn't kidding before when I told you guys that I am willing to listen to all issues. I'm not one of the, you know, I do have my ideologies, you know, but I am willing to listen to the other side. And that's how, you know, I've been successful in the city of Fond du Lac and city council. I've been elected twice and been president three times. And, you know, it's because of who I am and how I act.
One thing, in 2009, domestic partnerships became law in the state of Wisconsin, giving couples, same-sex couples, 43 of the more than 200 rights that are currently allowed to married couples. Governor Walker and his administration are working to undo that. It's still kind of moving through the court process. There was just news this past week that it's been referred back to another court or a lower court. If you're elected, Rick, do you intend to work toward undoing domestic partnerships in the state of Wisconsin?
You know, I don't believe in domestic partnerships. That's just who I am. I'm a married man. I'm a Christian,
and I'm a Christian too.
That's fine. I appreciate that, but I have my philosophies on that, and they're personal in nature. And you know, there's some things that I just won't deviate on. So,
okay, but so, will you work to undo domestic partnerships?
I personally would go along with the legislation, but I'm not personally going to undo it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So,
all right.
Okay. Should social issues like this even be in the Constitution? What the purpose of a Constitution is, to give rights, not to take them away?
You know, I'm all for simpler government, less government. You know, I think government's been too intrusive over the years. You know, it's kind of gotten away from our founding fathers the way they intended it. And I like to see some of that simplicity come back into government. I think it's just stonewalled so much that we're so heavy with regulations and government that, you know, it just makes sense to start undoing some of the things that have been done and, you know, let free markets be free and things of that nature. So,
limited government, I don't know where that comes from, but if you were elected, what less government would you like to have Wisconsin?
I think obviously there's a lot of agencies down in Madison are redundant. There's a lot of redundancy going on. I don't know, DOT stuff, I mean, it's just redundant. I mean, a guy wants to put a culvert in a ditch and you have to have three agencies look at it. You got the township, you got the county, and then you got DOT coming in. I think that's something that can be handled at the county level. I don't think DOT needs to get involved to put a culvert in a ditch. So, I mean, it's just simplistic things like that.
Some DNR things too?
The DNR over the years is, kind of gotten a heavy hand, and I think it's time that we take a look at that. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that, you know, some of the technical schools and the two-year colleges, I should call them, and four-year colleges should have a little more latitude in how they do things. Business. I mean, business should have a little more latitude in how they operate and run their businesses. So,
are there any, and we're almost out of time, but just real quickly, are there any Democratic issues that you would support, or any Republican issues from which you would deviate?
Do you have any examples you'd like to give me?
No, I'm just asking if you know.
I don't know of any hot button topics going on at this point. I mean, I've been focusing so much energy on my campaign and trying to keep the campaign going that I haven't really, you know, been privy to looking at issues and trying to, you know, decide what's going on. You know, if I win in November 6th, I'll have time after that to get into those things. So I'm not avoiding your question.
That's fine. I mean, you know, and we are out of time, but the big issues, of course, are the abortion and in health care and
pro-life.
Things like that.
I'm pro-life.
Okay. So. All right.
The big issues are going to be money and the budget. How much revenue is coming in and
exactly. And it's, we deal with that at the city level, municipal level every day.
Yeah. So. But it'll be a lot more in Madison.
Right.
Okay. All right. Well, good luck.
Okay.
And thank you very much for being here.
Sure.
That's going to do it for us. We will see you next time. Until then, take care. Keep your eye on us. We've got our eye on Oshkosh.